if God is in control of everything that happens, or worse yet, if he determines every single thing that happens, why pray? If he already knows how everything's going to turn out, then how could it turn out any other way? Then prayer would be superfluous at best. Now, we're going to look at a little bit of what's called the Lord's Prayer, but prayer accesses God's involvement. I once read a quote that said, prayer is not forcing God's reluctance. Like, give me that. No. You know, that would be praying hands. You ever seen praying hands? I don't know if that's praying hands either, because all you could get is handcuffs. But anyway, this is not praying hands like this. Maybe this is praying hands. Taking hold of, expecting to receive. Prayer is not forcing God's reluctance, but taking hold of God's willingness. That's why 1 John 5 says that we should pray according to the will of God. Some people teach that everything that happens on earth is the will of God. We're going to read in Matthew 6, that's not what Jesus said by any means. The point is that God does not have carte blanche to intervene and fix everything going on in the world. How do we know that? Because God is love. And one day in the future, Jesus will come and he will destroy all wickedness and death and evil and sickness. That's a hint that he would like to do it now, and he is doing it when he gets enough human cooperation. How come God did not stop that creep at Fort Hood who went in there and killed a bunch of our military personnel? Why didn't he stop him? Because he couldn't, which begs the question, why couldn't he? And the answer, we could think about David and Goliath. Did God stop Goliath? Sure he did, because some teenager said, dang. Why didn't God stop the guy at Fort Hood? He didn't have sufficient human cooperation. All it would have taken was for one person walking with God to cast out the demons that were infesting that murderous man. Well, Goliath was a murderous man, and God rocked him to sleep. Absolutely. So, prayer accesses God's involvement. Listen to this. Matthew 6, 7, it says, and when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans. In other words, chanting the same thing over and over. That's really what it's talking about, because that doesn't do any good. Watch, look what it says. For they think they will be heard because of their many words. There are some religions that tell you, well, if you say this 5 times, it's not as good as if you say it 10 times. So if you say it 10 times, God will like you better, or something will happen. Like, no, no. Verse 8, do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Then why do we ask him? Number one, prayer orients us to God as the source of all good things. Number two, as we're going to see, it makes things happen that would not otherwise have happened. I've got a piece of the Berlin Wall somewhere. I got it when I was in Berlin a long time ago. Right after the wall had come down, I guess I was in Germany, and somebody gave it to me as a gift. And it's got graffiti on it and so forth. How come that wall came down? Because enough people prayed, and finally, one person's prayer was the straw that broke the devil's back, and the wall came down. So, this then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven. Our Father, God, wants to be a Father to you. And if you're born again of His Spirit, He is your Father. He's only the Father of those that He's fathered, those that are born into His family. That's your choice. In heaven. In other words, he's got a better perspective on things. Hallowed, holy be your name. We are to praise and worship him. That's the focus of our coming to him. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Wait a minute, why would Jesus say to pray that if everything that happens on earth is the will of God? It wouldn't make any sense, right? There's too much stuff being promoted as Christianity that doesn't make any sense. And so that is what he says. And then he goes on, give us today our daily bread, one thing at a time. We just go day by day asking the Lord in the situations we're in, forgive our debtors, lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from the evil one. What evil one? The devil, whom Jesus revealed. Satan is not revealed in the Old Testament like Jesus revealed him. It was Jesus who uncovered. He uncovered the snare of the devil. Oh, my gosh. And showed that Satan is the cause of bad things. Now, God forbid that you spend your valuable time watching big time wrestling, WWE, whatever, Hulkamania, WrestleMania 28, or whatever. Okay, but maybe you like that kind of thing. It's a pretty good theater. In any case, they have what is called tag team wrestling. Let me explain it to you in case you haven't seen it. You have the ring with the ropes around the ring. There are two guys on a team, two against two. The rule is that only one man at a time can get in the ring. And the other guy, who is his partner outside the ropes, cannot jump in to help him unless the man inside reaches and touches him. That's the rule. If you've watched big time wrestling, you know that occasionally the rules are violated. My God, he just hit that man with a stove. The rules are occasionally violated. Both people are pounding one guy while the other guy is lying over there. But let's say the rules are followed. You're in a headlock. Sometimes in big time wrestling, your partner is out of reach. Jesus is never out of reach of your prayer, your petition, your obedience, your faith. But it's the same thing as big time wrestling in terms of Jesus. He doesn't have the right legally to just jump in the ring and start smacking the enemy who is attacking you. We must ask him why. It all goes back to the fact that God is just, and he gave Adam free will, and he gave Adam the dominion over the world, and Adam took it and gave it to the devil, and God could not just yank it back without violating his character and his free will. So he came up with plan B, that would be Jesus. And one day, Jesus will come when all is said and done, and God will be proven just and the justifier. Right now, the tares are growing up with the wheat. God is not willing that any should perish. He wants all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. But one day, Jesus is going to jump into the ring and obliterate the devil. And in the meantime, your prayers will enable God to get involved and make things different than they would have been had you not prayed. Now, again, I have a teaching called on our website, tltf.org, God's Foreknowledge and Man's Free Will. And I read some fabulous quotes about prayer as well as some verses and really put this thing together, and it has revolutionized my prayer life, because prayer takes effort. It takes time. Maybe I have to get up earlier and pray, or stay up later, or spend time praying instead of doing something else. And maybe I don't see anything happen immediately. I go by what the Word of God says, and it says, pray without ceasing. That doesn't mean you can do it just 24/7, but it means to always be looking. Just a short prayer here, there. God knows what's in your heart, and he will jump on your prayer and ride it into the arena of life on your behalf. Pray without ceasing.